For now, welcome to this event under the for SeaTech Week. And I think we'll basically just start off with just saying that I'm Sheila Heymans. I'm the Executive Director of the European Marine Board, and we will be talking today about the future of observations from the seabed to space, and specifically the training that's needed to support the marine science endeavors. So without further ado, I think I need to remind you that this is actually being recorded. So if you have any questions or so, those will be on the live e-event, but if you don't, you can't speak, so it will just be for the panelists to be aware that we are actually being recorded. I think we'll start with the introduction by the chair of the European Marine Board, Gilles Lericolais. Gilles is the chair of the European Marine Board, and he became chair in June 2019. He is presently the acting scientific officer for the French Prime Minister General Secretariat of the Sea. From 2011 to 2020, he was the international director of IFREMER. He received his PhD in 1997 and became a professor in 2009 in marine geology. He is on the internal advisory committee of JPI Oceans, and he's the vice chair of the French committee for the IOC of UNESCO. I think I can say quite a lot more about Gilles, but I'll end by saying it's really a pleasure to work with him. So I'll leave it to you, Gilles.
Okay, thank you very much, Sheila. So you say most of the thing about me, so I'm not gonna recall what you say. I am acting now as the European Marine Board Chair, elected in June 2019, as you said. And I will try to give you a brief introduction of what the European Marine Board is, who we are, and what we do as the purpose of this presentation. Next slide, please. So we work on marine science policy interference to provide advice on future research and policy needs, all related to marine issues. The European Marine Board is an independent and self-sustaining body, which is important, and covering a very wide range of marine science topic. We have been established in 1995, we became an independent legal entity in January 27. We became an independent Belgium legal entity at that time. In fact, we aim to have an European focus with an international outlook, but keeping, of course, a national connection. Next slide. The European Marine Board is a unique European think tank in marine science policy based on a partnership of major marine and oceanographic institutes, research funding agencies, and also national network of university. In 2020, the European Marine Board has 35 members, all connected in 18 countries all across Europe, of course, as we are named the European Marine Board. This represents over 10,000 researchers and technical staff. The board has recently decided to extend the European Marine Board membership to a maximum of 4 members per country, as previously it was only limited to 3. So we moved to 1 more members per country. The secretariat, as you see on the slide, is constituted by 5 very active and important colleagues who are all based in Ostend in Belgium. I'd like to recall the message statement of the European Marine Board, and let me read it. The European Marine Board provides a pan-European platform for its member organization to develop common priorities, advance marine research, and bridge the gap between science and policy in order to meet future marine science challenges and opportunities. Next slide, please. Oh, we transfer marine science knowledge and recommendation to marine policy, which is one important goal. We also transfer policy questions and needs back to the marine science community. In fact, from you see on the slide, science, strategy, and foresight, we provide advices through position papers, science and policy brief, conferences and forum, vision documents, in order to impact, of course, the European research area, research program and investment, capacity building, infrastructures, and sea and ocean management. All this targeting the Commission, the European Commission, I mean, the European Parliament, but also national policymakers and program management. The science community, together with the general public, is also one of our target, and this is an important point. Please, next slide. We provide our advice through events and publications. And on this slide, you have an overview of our activity. I'd like to underline the Eurasian conference, which is during through multiple days. And it's a science policy conference series, and it's co-organized with the European Commission, together with us, the European Marine Board. And usually, conference series are linked with the European presidency, and it's an important place to provide a call for action, for instance, especially for the presidency. We have also the European Marine Board Forum, which long for one day. And the objective is to bridge a gap between the science community and policymakers and act as a platform for discussion and shared knowledge. Another example over this conference series or forum is brown bag lunches. As the name is said, it's during lunch and it long 1.5 hours. And it's mostly directed to debate based on a topical area, a specific area we want to raise, especially to policymakers, the Commission, or other stakeholders. Next slide. Here is an overview of our current activities. Our working group of experts work with us to produce our publications. So the position papers and the publications are work with scientific experts who are working together in a working groups with a chair and a vice chairs and produce this publication. And the European Marine Board Secretariat is also active in European project funded by the European Commissions and go for tenders, and I can say we are quite successful, especially in action to support policy or orientations, especially scientific orientation for Europe and especially for the Commission. We have our new science webinars. This is probably due to the COVID-19 and all the problems we are facing today. And we have found out that using webinars is quite giving us a possibility to present the science, especially that underpins our publications, our position paper or scientific brief. And they take place once a month. So I recommend you to connect to these webinars, especially they are launched during the third Thursday of every month. So take that into account. Next slide. And to conclude, I can tell that this is a brief introduction, and you can find more about us on our website. You can also follow us for the Geek People on Twitter. And to conclude, I wish you a nice virtual week at SeaTech Week and a nice session today on the future of observation from seabed to space, training to support marine science. So thank you very much, and I leave the floor to the moderator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gilles. That's great. So I will just remind you that if you have any questions for any of our speakers, then please make sure that you go onto the Live website and put them in. I'm assuming that's how you guys are seeing this, and so you'll be able to give us the questions there. Okay, so next, we thought it would be helpful if we actually give you an overview of some of the training needs that we've required or we've highlighted in our documents. And so I'm going to quickly give you an overview of some of the training needs that have come out of all of our documents. Next slide. So Gilles was mentioning the fact that we have had 41 documents, and you can see here, this is just some of the front covers of some of them. We didn't put them all, I couldn't get them all on there, but from these publications, we've always or inevitably have recommendations, and mostly some of them will cover some sort of training needs. Next slide, please. Again, this is a reminder even to myself that we are talking specifically here about ocean observations, and obviously ocean observations underpin all of our marine and maritime activities, so they are critically important. And in order to have a fit for purpose ocean observing system, we need a wide range of expertise. So we need skilled designers, skilled users, and skilled analysts. So there's all sorts of different skills here that's mentioned. I'm not going to go into any details, but they're there. We need data managers, we need technologists, we need cooperation and so forth. Next slide. One of the things that have come up in quite a few of our most recent documents is that we really need transdisciplinary training. We need to move away from the usual traditional silo working where the natural scientists and the social scientists and the technologists and the generally the public aren't working together. So we really need to make sure that our graduates have a wider perspective of how their fields actually relate to the marine world. I think it's called a T-level training. So they need depth in one field, but also a broad perspective over the top. So some of the things that we think is important is we need co-design training content. So it shouldn't just be designed by one field. We need some transdisciplinary degree courses. Traditional degree courses should really have modules from other fields. And we also need joint project work with other fields so that you have physical scientists and biologists, for instance, working together. So you need to train current professionals to be able to work with other disciplines. It's really hard if you work in that interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary interface to understand each other. And so we need to train the professionals to work together. And it needs to be not just for the new scientists, not just for the students coming up, but it needs to happen at all levels of the career stages so that we can make the undertaking as smooth as possible. Next slide. So for graduates, there's obviously in our document on graduate science, there was quite a few things that came out that's really important that they found is very valuable in their training. And some of these things are the fact that they get training at sea and that they work with researchers abroad. They have work experience in industry. They gain an awareness of policy. They understand the real world projects. They're exposed to current methods and software and learning about communication and external engagement. These are the things that were very important for them. And of course, in order to do that, we need funding to support that, and we need long-term collaboration, and we need to provide access to appropriate infrastructure and resources. Next slide. Also, it's really important, as I said already, that we shouldn't just train the young scientists, the young students coming in, but we need to actually have lifelong learning. So we need basically to train the marine and maritime sectors that are constantly evolving. We need continuous professional development across maritime professions so that we can update and upskill workers. We need to increase collaboration between academia and the training providers as well, with academia and training providers with industry and policy makers. And we need to make sure that the training is flexible and accessible and engaging. Next slide. And so there's obviously a whole bunch of new professions that are coming up, new roles that are emerging as the maritime sector is evolving. And some of these are then some of the new professions that we will need to train people for. And some of these things you can adapt to what you've done before, but for some of these, you will really need new training. And so we basically need to ensure that our training provides the traditional foundation in the usual science fields, but then also meet the challenges that are coming in the industry and policy. Next slide. We also need to promote innovation. I guess I'm preaching to the converted here, but we really need to train professionals to be able to support and move towards the sustainable blue economy. we need to make the training in innovation and entrepreneurship entrepreneurship available to all. And we need to also train graduates in the sort of blue skies thinking. So just thinking about science for the sake of thinking about science, but then how do we use those to help address global grand challenges such as climate change and food security. Next slide. So we need to reskill and improve with opportunities as the landscape changes. And we need to improve the training and practical skills and provide apprenticeships, for instance. We need to standardize training across countries. That's one of the things that that's definitely come out, that sometimes the training isn't the same across all of the different countries. And we need to make sure that there are equal opportunities for training for resources and infrastructure across Europe. Next slide. So just finally, there's some overarching recommendations that we've come up with from all of our documents. And that is that through training, we need to make sure that the marine and maritime sector can meet the demand for skilled workforce. Through collaboration, we need to explore ways to provide dedicated training for a wide variety of roles, not just for graduates. We need to put in place strategic funding to support this training. We need to train professionals at all levels in transdisciplinary collaboration. We need to increase communication between academia and the training providers and industry and policymakers. We really need to explore transnational access to and similar approaches to address inequalities. And we need to highlight the attractiveness of the marine and maritime careers and raise awareness of the opportunities to maximize recruitment. And we could do that specifically through ocean literacy, for instance. So I'll leave it at that. And again, if you have any questions about any of our documents, please contact us. You see the webpage there. Yes, you can also put some questions in the question and answer section. So now I think we'll go to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Wendy Brown. Wendy is the Environmental Director for the International Association of Oil and Gas Producers, the IOGP. She's based in London, and her role involves directing the work of the IOGP on the environment, low carbon and decommissioning. And she's also working on two science joint industry programs. She's originally a biologist. She's got 30 years of experience in the oil and gas industry. And she's worked for 12 years as an environmental consultant. She's also worked for Total, which she joined in 2001. And she worked there in Aberdeen, Calgary and Paris. It's quite a nice spread of the Northern Hemispheres there, Wendy. And she's going to give us a presentation on why should the industry be involved in marine training and what opportunities are there for the industry. So take it away, Wendy.
Thank you very much, Sheila. And hello, everyone. So thank you for that kind introduction and very interesting presentations, both of you, on the European Marine Board. So when I look back to 30 years ago, when I graduated from Bristol University with my biology degree, marine biology mainly, I do remember that my careers advisors were not really much help at all. And at that time, you know, no one ever could have envisaged the sort of career that I've had, where I have managed to use my biology throughout my 30 years. But so I'm hoping to tell you a little bit more about the oil and gas industry and more generally the energy industry, I would say. As Sheila mentioned, I'm seconded from Total into IOGP in this role as Environment Director. And IOGP, for those of you not aware, is the global voice of the upstream oil and gas industry. We have over 80 members from all over the world, including from the majors through independents and the national industry associations. And many of our members are today becoming energy companies, integrated energy companies. We're obviously facing all the challenges of climate change, reducing our carbon footprint, and also the energy transition. So while I will just mention that the International Energy Agency have said that last year, oil and gas accounted for around 50% of the energy mix. Because energy demand is going to grow by about 25% by 2040, even in the most conservative scenario, oil and gas will still represent about 47% of the energy mix in 2040. So whilst some of you who are graduating or looking where to put your where to work in the future, certainly in the next next 20 years or so, there's a lot of work in our industry, and as I said, many of our members are becoming energy companies. So moving into renewables, wind, solar, and there's a lot of interesting careers. Next slide, Orla. So within IOGP, we have 11 standing committees, 8 joint industry programs, and I'm going to give you just a little snapshot into some of the sorts of work that we do within environment, geomatics, and metocean. So through the committees that we have within IOGP, we have the privilege to work with the top group specialists in environment, geomatics, metocean from many of our members. So we produce a range of good practice guides, work with scientists on a number of studies. So I'm going to give you just through that experience an example of some of the work that is done in the industry to give you a feel for the sorts of opportunities and needs that the industry has. So for those of you not aware, this slide gives you a very, very brief overview of the different phases in the exploration and production life cycle. We call it the E&P life cycle for oil and gas. And what you can see is right from the very, very earliest stages, all the way through seismic drilling, designing projects, installing them, operating throughout the life of the field through decommissioning. The information that we need at every stage for an offshore project, we need environmental and information on the marine environment at every single stage. On the environmental side, right from the earliest stage, we would undertake preliminary screening, collect environmental baseline data, assess the risks and impacts, do predictive modeling. So if that was for the seismic stage, looking at the, for example, the underwater sound and the potential impacts on the marine life in order to feed into the design of the seismic activity. Same at the drilling stage, we'd collect additional data and look at the potential risks and how we would manage them. And then if the project moved on to the development phase, again, there would be much more detailed baseline survey collected on the marine environment, impact assessments, and then throughout the life of the field, again, there's a need to collect data on the marine environment and monitor what's going on. And then all the way through to decommissioning, at the end of the life of the field, again, there's a need for more environment surveys, data to be collected. Next slide, Paula. So what I wanted to show is traditionally, we've gone out and collected that data through collecting seabed samples, water column samples. Of course, we also use sort of remote operated vehicles, side scan sonar, a number of different technologies. But more and more, there are new types of technologies that we're using And one of them is environment genomics. So as I said, the conventional approaches such as direct sampling and visual acoustic observations tend to be time consuming and expensive. So environmental DNA can be a method that can be faster, cheaper, and offer different or more comprehensive information. So I know this is already starting to be used by quite a lot of environment agencies around the world. Currently, for our industry, it's something which is a sort of emerging, and several operators are doing parallel surveys, both the conventional approaches and the environment genomics. And we've set up a joint industry program. You can see here the website if you want more information. And our goal is to develop guidelines for the application of environment genomics in environment management activities in oil and gas. So this is just one example where we're involving, you know, the latest marine science to sort of improve the way that we carry out our activities. Next slide. Another one of the joint industry programs that we run is called the Sound and Marine Life Joint Industry Program. And this is something that has been running since 2006, and the industry spent over $60 million so far in trying to advance the understanding of the interaction between sound from oil and gas operations. So the most common is sort of seismic activities, but there's also piling, there's noise from vessels, there's all sorts of sounds. And the purpose of this research has been to better understand and then to find out, you know, the best ways of reducing any impacts. And so there are five research categories. And all the work is done by independent scientists, and it's all encouraged to be published with independent peer-reviewed science. We've got over 140 publications, and again, you can find all this a bit freely available on the website. And then just as another example of a sort of an activity which is undertaken regularly at different stages throughout the life cycle is the MMO, which is the Marine Mammal Observer. So this is a mandatory requirement when they're starting up a seismic survey and then throughout the activity, and also for some drilling activities. So this is where you're observing the marine mammals from the surface. And one of the outputs from the Sound and Marine Life JIP was to improve the technology called PAM, which is passive acoustic monitoring. So that enables you to monitor marine mammals underwater, you know, when you can't see them from the surface, or, you know, throughout the day and night. Next slide. So this is just a couple of publications that are interesting if you want to learn more. Environmental management in the oil and gas industry is a sort of fundamentals, and that can show you the types of careers and activities that we undertake on the environmental side. Here's the website for the Sound and Marine Life JIP. You can find out a bit more there about the different research focus areas. And then the next topic I wanted to move on to is using both airborne and satellite remote sensing for environmental sampling and monitoring. And again, you know, with our activities often being undertaken in remote, difficult areas, this is something that's increasingly being used for environmental sampling. This is a publication that we made in March this year, very much for environmental professionals to interact with remote sensing professionals to get the best out of all the applications. So again, if you're interested in that, that's something that is very much an increasing technology that we're using within our industry. Next slide. OK, please. So moving on to geomatics. Obviously, as I've said, in terms of remote sensing, this is something that's being increasingly used in the oil and gas industry. In terms of the data used throughout the life cycle, 80% is spatially georeferenced. So it's absolutely critical for our industry, whether we're identifying the location of where we're undertaking the seismic survey, whether we're identifying the location of where we're going to drill a well and conducting a survey around that, throughout the life cycle, as you can see on this slide, you can see all the survey and position integrity and geospatial data requirements across the full life cycle. Next slide, please. And as I mentioned as well, the geomatics group within IOGP very much develops the primary global source of spatial guidance necessary to ensure the geodetic integrity. So again, they're all freely available on our website. You can have a look there under the geomatics to see all the different types of guidance. And often these are used not just within the oil and gas industry, for a lot of positioning and reference sources by other marine users as well. So, as I said, the knowledge, the oil and gas industry has benefited, for many, many years from qualified survey and geospatial personnel. And they are essential to our industry to maintain sufficient specialist knowledge to acquire, manage, and visualize spatial data. So this is something, it's been required for many years. And moving on, for all the other types of energy industries, whether you're talking about where to locate offshore wind turbines, this is a very, very crucial discipline that we need within our industry. Next slide. So, and finally, to come to metocean, and obviously, this is very important when you're carrying out a seismic or drilling activity, when you're designing the well, you need to have very good information on the metocean characteristics of your area. Often, when companies are moving into new areas, they will collect metocean data throughout the water column for a whole year before they actually undertake any activities, so that they have enough data. And on this slide, you can see some of the projects that are being undertaken in different parts of the world. And often they're joint industry projects together with scientific organizations or academic institutes and things. And you can see again on the website those and how they are then built into structure design, and of course also personnel, asset and operations safety. Next slide. And finally, I wanted to also show you in terms of the metocean side, how the members of the oil and gas community work closely with metocean forecast service providers and academic and government specialists to collect better data to inform, again, the activities. And often these are shared in the different regions with the other sea users. These just give you some of the examples. In 2018, we had a workshop with a number of both international and regional experts looking, understanding the spread of the physical risk for the oil and gas industry. There's also been various more specialist activities looking at tropical storms and tropical cyclones. And again, you know, having very accurate forecasting and information on those is absolutely critical for the planning and operating of our activities. So that's another area where there are many needs from the industry. Next slide. So I think that's probably where I'll stop. Happy to answer any questions. As I said there are, that's just a little snapshot of some of the examples, some of the potential areas where we need marine scientists. There are also many, many industry science collaborations that our industry gets involved with. Happy to talk about these and any other questions that you may have. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Wendy. That was great. I am not seeing any questions on the question and answer portal. So I'm assuming nobody had any questions for you or Gilles, or maybe they just don't care. But to be honest, I have a question for you. How are we doing for time? Yes, I'm going to ask my question. So that was a really great overview of the work that you guys are doing. But what do you think is the most important reason for the industry to work with, you know, academic institutions? And I mean, if you could say one thing that really would be your elevator pitch for why the industry should work with academia, I'd be nice to hear.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I think throughout my career, there have been many, many occasions where it's been very, very valuable for industry to work with science. So I take one example. So when I started, the industry was starting to explore west of Shetland. We had very, very little data on the Atlantic margin. So what was set up was something called the Atlantic Frontier Environmental Network, which was a network where industry worked with regulators and worked with scientists. And they were scientists from Dunstaffnage Marine Laboratory, where I know Ben is, and many other Scottish laboratories who were already starting to research in these areas. And together we designed a program. And with the scientists, they collected data that would form a baseline, identify where were the potential risks for the industry. And it was also a benefit, so it was win-win for the industry and for the scientists. The scientists could collect data on little known species that they'd never studied before. They would have access through our remote operated vehicles and through the survey equipment and technologies that we maybe had access through the industry. So it was win-win for everybody. I mean, we managed to collect baseline data, understood how we needed to conduct our activities to minimize any impacts. The scientists managed to collect more data and further their understanding of these sort of deep water areas. And then there's been others, for example, Serpent, which is run from the National Oceanography Centre in Southampton, which is again where science and industry have worked together. It's making use of downtime from ROVs on drilling vessels throughout the world. And again, that's been beneficial both to the scientists and to industry. The scientists have had access to areas that they would just never have known about, never have had access to. And they've also been able to use those opportunities to further understanding of the science. And another couple, which I know are European funded projects called Atlas and iAtlantic. And they're opportunities where industry can contribute some of this data that I've mentioned, you know, that we may have collected from metocean bathymetry, the data that we've collected for baseline or monitoring surveys in different parts of the world. You know, we have this concept of single-use plastic. Well, for the industry, often it's single-use data. You know, they may collect it, it will only have one purpose. And more, we're encouraging our members, and often members do this anyway, but they don't all do it enough, to be better at sharing their data. And that's something that we're encouraging through particularly this iAtlantic project, which is a massive project looking at the health of the ocean, the whole Atlantic Ocean. So those are just some of the reasons why I think industry and science collaborations are fruitful. And so, yeah, I think, and I think, you know, there's been, yeah, they can be beneficial from both sides. And yeah, I think it makes sense.
Thank you very much. That was quite helpful. Okay, I think, I don't know, there's still no other questions, but I think if we go through the through the talks, then we will have some time for a panel discussion at the end. So I think I'll come back to you with some more questions afterwards. Okay, next we will have Ben Wilson. He's going to be talking about basically the other side of it, so coming more from the academic side. So Ben is an ecologist by training, and he's basically studied the relationship between wildlife and offshore industries. I know Ben for a long time. We were postdocs together a very long time ago. And he was working then on marine mammals and fish interactions and the noise produced by anthropogenic activities. He's still doing so. He currently works in Scotland at the Scottish Association for Marine Science, or Wendy called it by its old name, the Dunstaffnage Marine Lab. SAMHSA's Scottish Association for Marine Science is a part of the University of the Highlands and Islands. And Ben is going to talk about more transdisciplinary training, and I'll leave it to him to enlighten you guys. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Sheila, for the introduction, and thank you also for the previous talks. I now understand why I'm here about to speak, so penny has dropped. So what I'm going to talk about is a doctoral training centre. It's been running since 2012. And has trained around 60 to 70 doctors of engineering, so DEngs, amongst three different universities working on marine renewable energy. Next slide, please. And the focus is on offshore wind, wave energy, and tidal stream energy, and it's a programme that's run by the University of Edinburgh, University of Exeter, and Strathclyde University in Glasgow. So it's a UK-based programme funded by UK research councils, though students attending have obviously come from a lot of nations, including across Europe as well. And my involvement is in two particular summer schools, which I'll be talking about, in terms of trying to broaden the skills that the students have and broaden their perspectives. And it's in the programme called ID Core Industrial Doctoral Training Centre for Offshore Renewable Energy. Next slide, please. So just to break down how the course works, is it's a four-year course. PhDs normally are 3 years, but this one includes effectively a master's at the beginning, giving the students all the skills they need to go off and do their research projects. So the rows are the different years here, and you can see by colours there's courses on in the first year on engineering skills, management skills, group design, projects, solving problems, and then there's several on what's called the marine environment, and that's what I'm going to talk about at the end of the first year and the second year. The grey, and then there's a number of other courses scattered through the program, giving them the skills they need to provide theses and get jobs and so on. The grey material is basically secondments where they go off into industry, do projects on their own with different industrial partners, and So they're projects that the industrial partners need to sort to do the things they need, genuine R&D. Next slide, please. And so over the years, there have been a wide number of companies that have supported the projects. They pay some of the stipend for the students, and then they accept the student in amongst their workforce to do genuine cutting edge projects that the companies need. Next slide. Here's my illustration of which goes back to Sheila's introduction. Basically, when you have a new industry coming into the field or a new set of challenges, you have a forest of unknowns, and you have a number of workers working away to cut down those unknowns to produce them into known things. And at the beginning, you tend to have very specific task, technology, and the people that are working on that generally quite close together in terms of, so if it was marine renewables, they'd be working on hydrodynamics and the engineering challenges associated with getting energy out. Next slide, please. As time goes on, the cutting and the forest of unknowns becomes more knowns, cut down trees, if you follow the analogy, and the practitioners, people involved in that, become increasingly far away as the cutting edge moves out into the more unknowns, becomes more sophisticated and so on. And the challenge, I guess, we have, which goes back to the introduction for this workshop, is really around those people become further and further as they become more specialized on the topics they, on the cutting edge gets further away from all the other topics. And how do we increase the connectivity of the people that are at that cutting edge that's obviously further into the forest? Next slide, please. And so that's where these summer schools, the two modules I'm going to be talking about, come in the sense that this is an industrial doctorate of engineering and provides the skills. However, as marine renewables have got more sophisticated, they've bumped into other issues, other stakeholders and other problems, consenting being a significant one. And so these two summer schools are there for the engineers to understand some of these other issues, so that they can translate their skills and understand some of the constraints they're operating under. Next slide, please. So for those two summer schools, as Wendy and Sheila both talked about, they went to SAMS, which used to be called the Dunstan Appridge Marine Lab. It's a marine lab on the west coast of Scotland, where in terms of teaching, it gives students an opportunity to actually see and play with a lot of the opportunities and challenges that face these industries. Next slide, please. So for the summer schools, they come for a fortnight, 2 weeks, and in the end of the first year, having learned a lot of things about the engineering constraints, issues, challenges, and so on, they come out and they learn about the environment, the marine environment, the natural environment. They learn about the legislation protecting species and habitats, why these are concerns. They learn about how the sea works, basically, in the natural environment, and so on and so on. So they have 2 weeks learning about the natural environment that constrains and also grows on in terms of fouling devices they're putting into the sea. Next slide, please. And I guess it's really key is we're not trying to teach them to understand everything about the issue. What we do is we take a 3-year undergraduate degree and boil it down to 2 weeks, and we basically show them the highlights. We focus on fun in the sense that we get them out in the sea, experiencing the habitats, the challenges, how to do the field work, whether it's raining or not, how hard it is to spot different marine mammals or birds, or what does it feel like to work with fouling species and so on. So we focus on the fun bit of it so that they're excited and interested, enthusiastic, which always comes out. But we also, they understand where the constraints and sensitivities are. Next slide, please. As well as getting them out into boats, we get them onto the seashore to see what invasive species look like, these kinds of things. So as engineers, this is all new to them, but they get a feeling for what an ecologist sees for marine renewables. Next slide, please. And the same thing for the social science module. So in the second year, after they've gone off and they've been in industry for a year, they come back and they learn about other stakeholders, other interests, marine spatial planning, competition for marine real estate, consenting processes, marine governments, these kinds of things. And we take them out again out in boats, we take them into society, we take them down to the supermarket, talk to different stakeholders of the sea so they understand those viewpoints. Thank you. Next slide, please. So just to kind of summarize, they kind of learn, I mean, we're not trying to teach the whole thing, we just give them a feel, a taste of the issues, but they realize the sites that they consider for marine renewable development, that site also has different issues and workers in the area use different languages, I put inverted commas, they're not languages as in French and Spanish and English, the languages as in the tech word we use. And also as teachers, we learn a lot of the languages that they use. I had no idea that in engineering, control is actually a significant word. I missed it in all the previous meetings I've been to until I spoke to them. There are differences. Environmental sciences is complex, it is actually expensive. Uncertainty is a huge thing we deal with in ecology. It's not necessarily such a big thing in engineering. Stakeholders' perspectives vary in space and time. Ask the same question in 1 year in one place and you get one answer, and ask the same question of the same people a couple of years later in the same place and you'll get a different answer. Very different from engineering kind of constraints. I've learned that ID course students are not afraid of equations. Show an equation, the entire class leans forward, which is a new thing for me teaching ecologists. And also it's really interesting that I think the students have gained a lot from talking about things like philosophy. What is truth? What is science? In engineering terms, these are very different questions, but when you get into the social science realm, all bets are off and it's a different game. One thing we focused on after several years, at the beginning of the course, the students would be asking why we're doing this. We're engineers, why are we doing this? We want to study gearboxes or something to do with mechanics. And so what we've done is brought previous students that are in industry back and they give a little talk, so only a few minutes, but they just say what they got from the course and how in everyday use they're actually using stuff from this course when they're in amongst companies. And that's been really useful to get them on board from the start. Next slide, please. So that's really a run through the ID Core program. It's an engineering doctorate. It's open to new students and companies at this moment, open till 6th of November for companies if they want to host students. Last slide, Sheila. Just to say that the program has been, as of last week, has become a finalist in the Scottish Green Energy Awards. So we're all fingers crossed for the award ceremony later on in the year. That's me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ben. That was great. And yes, it really was precisely why I wanted you to speak, because I think it gives a very good perspective from the other side. So I'll ask you a similar question to what I asked Wendy. You know, if you had, again, what's your elevator pitch to academia for why is it useful to work with industry? Why is it useful for academics? I mean, I remember, because I taught on that course when I was at SAMHSA, I remember how it was, how do I, you know, fit my 5-day course into a half day sort of teaching? So how do you convince the scientists that this is actually a worthwhile thing to do?
Well, I think now convincing the teachers to teach on the course, these are active research scientists, is one of the most favorite courses we teach. I have no problem getting the teachers to sign up to their lectures and practicals and so on, because the students are very high quality. It's quite a difficult course to get into, so they pick good students, so it's a fun to teach them, but also they're very engaged and we're focusing on the fun side of what we do. We're not trying to get them to understand it so they can be a practitioner. We're trying to get them to understand the landscape of the projects that we're doing, so we can focus on the fun bits, just so they understand the sort of space we're operating in. And in fact, as a really key example, I was kind of wary about whether students should, that Sheila just teach on the course, because what you're teaching is quite specific about food webs and so on. They really enjoyed that. and signing up to the final practical course, they signed up to and talked about it ever since. The other side of this is I come across these students every day in my actual working life. I go to a meeting and I meet with an industry about some survey or other, and one of the students will be sitting on the other side of the table as part of the project team in whatever company it is. So that's fantastic. We've got personal relationships working on the other side effectively. So once it's got going, it's not a difficult thing to convince the academic side.
And just a follow-up question, how many students have you trained so far? I mean, how many, do you have a tally, is like 100 of them, or how many are there?
It's been going on for 8 years now. It's about 10 a year. There's been a couple of difficult years for whatever reasons. It's over 60 students now, 60 or 70 students. In fact, there's another bunch coming, so it'll be into the 70s now. But it's spooky how often I bump into them at conferences and meetings and stuff like that.
Thank you very much, Ben. Okay, I think we'll go to our final speaker, and then we'll have more of a discussion, because we can talk about that quite a bit more. So our last speaker is Lucia Fraga Lago. I'm sure I completely mispronounced your last name, but anyway, we'll stick with Lucia. So Lucia is a graduate from the Sea Sciences of the Sea program, and she has been she's in 2002, and she coordinates the training department of the Technology Center of the Sea, SETMAR, and she develops projects to promote the blue skies, blue skills, and ocean literacy. And she has been responsible for the management of the Axola Training Center since 2004, and the Blueprint Mates project, which I think is what she's going to be talking about today, where they basically create a skill strategy for shipbuilding and offshore renewable energy sectors. So since 2011, she's been an expert of the European Commission on the ESCO board, which is the reference group for agriculture, forests and fisheries. And she's participated in the expert group on skills and careers development in the blue economy. And she's also part of the EU for Ocean platform, which is an ocean literacy platform, which the Marine Board is also part of, and it's really interesting. So Lucia's going to present on what are the trends and needs in marine training that they foresee. And I think, as I said, it's going to be from the Mates project. So Lucia's all yours.
Thank you very much, Sheila, for your presentation. Yes, I will present some of the results of the MAIDS project that we are conducting at this moment. So, next slide, please. This project is it's a blueprint project, which is one of the sectoral alliance projects that the European Commission is promoting, with the aim to bring together the industry, the education community, and also the research community and any other stakeholders to improve the skilling of all the sectors in Europe. We are bringing together 17 partners from Europe in this project, from all these different profiles, which are being coordinated by the SETMAR Center, the Technology Center for the Sea, which I belong to. Our role is usually this linking together these different type of stakeholders. We are like knowledge brokers that promote marine research and innovation. In the case of the training area, what we promote is this innovation and research addressing better skills and for the marine community. That has not only the partners, but also a group of more than 180 experts and stakeholders that are involved to better align our activities to the needs of the community. So next slide, please. The goal of this project is to create a skill strategies for the future maritime technologies. They're addressing shipbuilding and offshore renewable sectors, considering them in the whole and their whole value chain, which includes ocean observation and research and any activity which is related with these sectors, which are also linked together because with differences, one is more traditional sector, the other one is a very new sector, but they are very close by many of their activities. What we have as an objective is to match the demand and the supply of skills. And for this, we are creating, first of all, an analysis of what is offered at this moment and what can we expect to be needed in the future. And we have proposed a set of action lines to better align this offer to the demand, which is existing at present, and the demand that we expect in the future. We are addressing especially some sets of skills, digital skills, green skills, but also those transversal skills that are also called 21st century skills, which are very related these transdisciplinary skills that have been mentioned before by many of the speakers today, and that may be the difference for someone with a very solid technical capacity, but these transversal skills may help to get a better work if we can do a better innovation management we have some entrepreneurial skills, communication skills, these not so technical skills that are supporting this capacity to create a better job, to get a better job. The project is at present validating some of the suggestions that have arisen from this proposed action line in a set of pilot case studies. And personally, we also are addressing the need for better inclusiveness of these sectors and in particular gender balance, and also increase the attractiveness of the maritime careers. And we consider that a better knowledge of the ocean literacy, can be a support for this attractiveness of the maritime careers. So, show today some of our results regarding to the analysis of the training needs and the future trends. So, next slide, please. There are many reports about the needs and skills gaps, but I will just make a short picture of the landscape on each one of the two sectors that we are addressing, because we found very different, we analyzed more than 450 education and training programs from all education levels. And we found that for the shipbuilding, there was a big offer on vocation and education training programs, but mainly addressing the first phases of the specialization. And many of them were not directly targeting the shipbuilding industry. There was not a big specialization in them. And most of them were in the language of the country in which they were provided. Only 70% were built or in English. And these were mainly the higher education programs. For the renewables training offer, what we found was that very few programs were directly addressing the offshore renewable energies. Most of them were addressing renewable energies or any other fields related with the renewables, but not directly this specialization. And most of them were master degree programs. Here we found much more English programs or bilingual programs. Indeed, this is related with the fact that most of them were of higher education. And what we found in regarding the future needs, to analyze the future needs was a Delphi analysis, which is shown in the next slide. And we made some questionnaires to these groups of experts. Please, can you go to the next slide? About the future trends that we were expecting in each one of these sectors. We found that for some of the trends that were going to affect the sectors, some of them are expected to have a higher impact in jobs. In particular, and these new trends are going to make some, to boost the emergence of some new occupations and also existing occupations that are not so important in the sector by now. And that there will be a need for improving the training to better capacitate the workers and also to prepare the new workers for these emerging occupations. So we can see that, for instance, vessel automation and digitalization are going to have a higher impact in the shipbuilding sector. And so, for instance, the digitalization trend will start having an impact by now, and they will create new occupations like robotics, automation, or cybersecurity. And we also analyzed the type of training that would better match the needs regarding to these trends. So for instance, in this case, for the shipbuilding, it will be very important on-the-job training and also the lifelong learning, but also some other types of training will be important, like webinars combined with on-the-job training, or even MOOCs for these digitalization trends. Another new trend that will have a high impact are the alternative fuels, with new emerging occupations that are going to be important, like the related with energy management, but also with alternative fuels and innovation management, which is an existing occupation that will be much more important for these sectors in the future years. For the offshore renewable energy, we found that again, on-the-job training will be very important to better prepare workers for the new trends, but also trainings provided by other training providers will have an importance since the beginning of the impact of these new trends. And we can see that the smart grid and sensors are having an impact by now, and also big data, and they will lead to new emerging occupations as big data analyst, sensors, engineer and technician, and big data systems. So we also analyzed some other trends, but I just put those that are having a high impact. And we also analyzed the needs that will be related with these transversal skills in order to a better adaptation to these new trends. I don't show everything in the slide because it's a lot of information. In the next slide, we can see our next step, which was to analyze how better address these new needs for the sectors. So we proposed and we evaluated with our external experts 10 lines of action for the shipbuilding sector and 12 lines of action for the offshore renewables energy sector. And then we have built a set of pilot experiences that are addressing either both sectors or one of them. So I will just show a couple of these pilot experiences to show how are we proceeding in the project to better analyze how could we address these needs we have identified. But we'll recap first in the next slide some of the lessons learned from this analysis. So we have that there is a need of new capabilities and skills and especially specialized training offer for the maritime industry. And we also saw a lack of educational offer addressing specifically offshore renewable energies. So we think that we need for mechanism to facilitate the completion of the training pathways, not only creating new trainings, but providing bridges to better combine the existing trainings and profit from other sector trainings that could be useful for these new needs. We also found, and this is maybe something that happens for many sectors, that at least industrial maritime sectors need to attract talent. But it may happen to many other sectors because we are living in a time in which we are having less workers entering in the industry. But for the maritime sectors, we think that raising the level of ocean literacy could contribute to reverse this trend. So making people more aware of their impact on the ocean and the impact of the ocean in them is part of an attraction for working for a better and safer ocean. And finally, we found that the skills needs are constantly evolving and the rig accelerates. We had the impact of COVID in the middle of this project, and we found, for instance, that many of the trends that we have been analyzing in the precedent months were impacting faster in the sectors. So any analysis that we could do will be old in a moment. So we need to develop meeting points for the most relevant stakeholders from industry, academia, and research in order to continue analyzing the landscape and proposing solutions in a dynamic way. We consider that transversal skills are having an increasing importance because they also facilitate adaptation. And also, and this was one of the trends that accelerated a lot with COVID, is the need to adaptate to remote learning, online or blended, taking into account that it will be very difficult for many disciplines, but this is a trend that is a lot of impact in this moment. And also we found some barriers to collect information related to vocational education and training because most of the information is not translated to English and is not easily available in big databases. And also these language barriers are a barrier for mobility of the trainees. So these were our main lessons learned, but I will show a couple of pilot experiences. The first of them in next slide is one of the experiences that is more, let's say, desktop based, because what we are doing is an analysis of these needs of skills and knowledge for the existing occupations in the sector, but also for those that are emerging. And we are including all this information in the ESCO database, which is a database on European skills, capacities and occupations that presents all the occupations of all the sectors in terms of defining them, but also defining the skills and the knowledge that are relevant for them. So this is an analysis that has been started, but that will continue in the following months. And we are analyzing also these transversal skills and knowledge that are needed for occupations. We have included ocean literacy and ocean literacy principles in the ESCO. We have proposed to include them in the ESCO database as relevant to all the marine occupations. This is a concept that was not so known in the past years, but that we consider that it's quite important for the better development of all the marine occupations. And we are at present involving external experts in the evaluation of all the recommendations we are transferring to the ESCO database. Our idea from the project is to facilitate the transfer of information to the ESCO database, because the way in which all the occupations and the skills and capacities are defined is somehow complex. So what we consider is that we will try to facilitate for the experts to just review as answering easy questions and validate the what we are proposing to include in this database. So if any of the presence is interested in this process, please contact, because we are just starting to open the process. We will have a webinar to present our results in November, and then start sharing with the expert that may be interested only in review one occupation or one type of skills, but this is the idea, to simplify it for the externals. And finally, I would like to show a very different pilot experience related with the need of attracting talent to these sectors. So in this case, we are addressing the secondary school community. And we can show you directly a video of that we have prepared. Please go ahead with the video. I will just talk over it.
We can't hear you.
Can we put a little bit lower the volume? Yes. We are with this video, with this experience, we are creating a non-formal training context to interest the youngsters in the maritime technologies.
And, sorry, can you guys see the video? Because I'm not seeing the video.
Oh no, I am not neither.
Paula, you might want to try again. Nope, it's not there.
Never mind.
Maybe we can get the video later.
It's always a surprise with the videos in the in these remote meetings. We had some images of the students. What we've done here is to profit an existing event, which is a contest promoted by an enterprise, an engineering enterprise, Marine Instruments. And they have a contest with secondary school students. They make groups to create a maritime vehicle, radio controlled, and working with solar energy. And from the MATES project, what we did was a set workshops to better prepare not only the students but also the teachers. These are optional workshops, because this is not part of their curriculum, and they come on Fridays afternoon and also Saturdays morning. It's completely a volunteer, to improve the team working and also different the use of different materials for the development of the other vehicles. And what we are also working within making them aware of how can they reduce the impact in the ocean with their project and how the ocean is impacting in their project. So we are working with the ocean literacy concepts in a transversal way. And we found a high interest in all these trainings, and also it is being working like a hook to make more present these maritime career opportunities in a moment in which the students are considering what are they going to study in the future. So this is our pilot experience addressing this specifically, this attractiveness. And this is all that I had to put, and this is what I have to present, to talk about the future trends. It's a very big project, so I try to make some examples. Hope it was not too much information in so short
time. Thank you very much. Thanks, Lucia. I don't know if we're going to get that video to play. I'm not sure if that is going to be possible. I'm sorry that didn't happen. I guess I could ask you a similar question to what I asked the other two speakers. What do you think is the one thing you'd want to say both to the trainers and to the industry? How can we make this happen better?
I think it's very valuable when we get this between the industry, the academia, and the researchers, because it makes really more adapted results and to the needs of each one of them. But I also agree that it's difficult for all the participants because we have quite different rhythms in the academia, in the training, and in the industry. And we are also rewarded in a different way. For instance, for a researcher, the approachment to the industry is an effort that is not recognized because they are then recognized in terms of the publications of what they are doing. For a teacher, we have mainly the same. They have good results maybe when they are doing their course, but when they are presenting for a post, they are not rewarded by that. They are rewarded by the trainings they have received and different types of parts of the curricula, but not for approaching the industry. And for the industry, it's also the same. They are rewarded by production normally, not by having made efforts in getting more future good students willing to enter the industry. So I think that we have a challenge here to better improve the recognition of these efforts for all the participants in these skills ecosystems. And this is something that we will have to work in. It's the same, it's a very similar problem that we have with ocean literacy and also the science communication for the researchers and the teachers, which is finally not really recognized in the careers. So this is my opinion regarding to that.
Thank you, Lucia. I was told in the chat that, in fact, Paula can show us the video now. So, Paula, are we going to take two on that one?
that video is the general presentation, but in our webpage there are some videos about the workshops with some you can follow them to better learn about the techniques that are being addressed in the workshops.
Thank you very much, Lucia. So I see we have one question in the question and answer. Section. So if the panel can come back, that'd be great, so people can see you. But unfortunately, I think this question is more towards myself and Gilles, but I will read the question. The question is by Mr.
Laurent Delaunay.
Thank you. His question is that training are taking place in many organizations and national projects, EU projects, ERICS, and so on, but there's no way to federate all the efforts to get, so that there's no possible duplication. And he's talking about there is an EOS technology forum that's happening tomorrow afternoon, also through CTEC Week, definitely worth having a look for everybody who has the time. And he's suggesting that this could be a way to federate such training. And then the question is, does the Marine Board work in a way to federate training efforts and avoid duplication? I'm going to have a go and then I'll give it over to you, Gilles. Firstly, the Marine Board has a universities panel. And so through that, we have actually looked at sort of different training and maybe how we could, how one university consortium can learn from another. I don't actually believe that you can duplicate too much training. I think the more you duplicate training, the better. But I think we need to be aware of what training is there and kind of, So basically for students in Spain to have duplication of what training there is in France, for instance, is not necessarily a bad thing. But I think it should be good. It would be good if the training is, if everybody's aware of all the training and precisely what the training is actually delivering. So that's my answer. I don't know what you want to say, Gilles, if you want to add to that.
Thank you, Laurent, for the questions. And I understand in a sense, and especially as you refer to EOS, the European Observation of Ocean Systems, which is very important. So there is a difference between, I will say, educations and operating systems and the way that we try to mutualize and to make them interoperable and so on. But we need to have the training everywhere we can. So it's like to say that we need only one university, we will do only one course everywhere. It's a little bit difficult to have a sort of type of training. But it's what we are doing, trying to do at the European Marine Board, as Sheila said, is to see what the university is giving us training, what are their level, and how we can make some capacity exchange or capacity building in the same direction, especially for specific orientation. And as you raise the information about the European Operating Ocean Observation System, I think this is also important that we try to coordinate at the European level the observation of the ocean. And as you know, you signed with Eurogus, and you know that the European Marine Board is working very jointly together with Eurogus to try to make this system appear and be financed and sustained. And this is an important point. So we have connected with the Joint Programming Initiative. We'll gather the finance agency to try to see how we can support. To come back and end on the training, I think we can have a line and exchange, but it's very difficult to make something what we do not duplicate. I would say we need to duplicate probably the same thing in different places to have the people at the same level everywhere, and sometime to try to exchange, because in the exchange you make a lot of different vision. And you create the vision different, and you make the innovation going faster in that case. So in a way, sometimes it's not the solution to make only one systems for education, but it's good to have one system interoperable for the observation to observe the same thing or to have the same results. So it's just a little bit different. So I don't know if I answered your question, but is this a vision we have?
Yeah, I can only agree with that, Gilles. I think EOS is really trying to coordinate the observations. And I think we need to make sure that that is done consistently. I think there is a place for having best practice of training. What is the training that's needed? And I think the stuff that's being done under MATES is a really good place to start with that. But I think there's also some work to look at the kind of best practice or the good things that's come out of things like ID Core that might really be helpful for how that can work closer together. So I don't know if anybody else wants to address that. I will add that under EOS, we actually working also trying to work closer together with the industry so that we can make sure that we also get the observations. I know Wendy was talking about the fact that they have the kind of depth of the data that is collected only once and not actually used again. And we're desperately trying to make sure that we work closer together with the industry so that the observations that we make is actually, or the observations that they make is actually then also incorporated into this framework, which we call EOS, which is the European Ocean Observing System, which is in fact not a system, but a framework. So I think if nobody else has, Ben, you look,
yes.
You want, Ben, do you want to say something? Sorry, and then Lucia.
I guess it goes back to something Lucia was talking about as well, is a lot of things you want to train for is the future, and it isn't in the world we live in now, it's the future world that the people that are being trained will live in themselves and operate in, and the training we need to provide is something that isn't, you know, stuff that we were taught passing on. You're training stuff that's completely new and developing, and that's a real challenge. And I guess one of the things to think about is what is over the horizon 10 years away of the challenges, and how do we bring those into the taught programs of now, particularly when the people that are teaching won't necessarily know that sort of stuff. So it's a kind of double challenge of looking over the horizon and thinking about, and it's the teachers have to step way out of their comfort zone in order to provide the skills for the futures. I'll shut up.
Lucia?
I was just wondering, because in the question, Laurent asks about any federation of efforts, and what I can say is that we found a good database of information on marine training in the marine training platform. It's run by the University of Ghent, and they have at present more than 2,000 programs in the database accessible to review, and it's also in many different levels and addressing many different marine subsectors. What we have done with the MATES project is to contribute to continue feeding this database, and all these hundreds of training programs that we have reviewed on the for the shipbuilding and the offshore renewable energy sectors have been included in the database. But it includes lots of programs, and it's also possible to review past programs, which are maybe not being provided at present, but have been provided in one moment. And I think a very interesting resource in order to get ideas and link good practices regarding to training. It also includes more than 600 organizations and institutes from more than 55 countries. And they will soon have also training resources in the database.
Thank you very much, Lucia. Okay, I don't see any other questions, but I think I have a few, and I'm going to go to Wendy because we haven't heard from her in ages. She's probably getting bored. So Wendy, so my question is, in which areas of marine training would you like to see closer collaboration between research and industry? If you think about the oil and gas industry, you know, where is it that you think this is where we could really make a difference. And if we could just train these guys now, you know, in 5 years' time, we'll have the people that can actually really do what we need. So what is it that you think would be quite helpful?
Okay, thank you, Sheila. And yeah, I think it was a very good point that, you know, Ben was making in terms of they're trying to train students for something way in the future that is very difficult for them to know what it is. But I mean, obviously I can't say exactly, but what I can tell you is the sort of direction that I see happening. And I see a lot of fantastic, you know, looking into the future from different members of, you know, what are oil and gas will look like. And obviously I can see from the other presenters, you're focusing on already on offshore renewables, because nobody wants to work in oil and gas anymore, of course. But as I said, it's very true that even in, you know, 20 years time, half of our energy will still come from oil and gas. So whether you're talking about renewables or oil and gas, I'll tell you, so without a doubt, I mean, some of the stuff I think Lucia has mentioned, but the designs of the future are all much, much smaller. They're much, much subsea, much more autonomous, much more controlled from onshore. So all this sort of, you know, the engineers that, you know, all the digital, you know, the robotics, subsea, you know, of the future, they're much, much smaller, much more smaller footprint. A lot of them are all starting to be electrified, you know, either electrified from onshore or, you know, offshore renewables potentially. So driving down the footprint. I mean, most of our members, or a lot of our members, are already setting their net zero carbon footprint roadmaps. You know, whether it be by 2040, 2050. So how are they getting there? So improvements in energy efficiency, electrification, reductions in, you know, flaring, methane emissions. But then the big wins will be in the carbon capture and storage, which is obviously not only from oil and gas, it's also from other sources of, you know, cement, you know, and they're looking at these hubs. So you've maybe heard of Net Zero Teesside, other hubs sort of in Amsterdam, in Norway, they've got this massive project, the Northern Lights project, where they're taking CO2 emissions from cement plants and waste recovery, and they're transporting the CO2 and then they're injecting it in geological formations offshore. If you look on our website, you can see CCS projects planned throughout Europe and even throughout the world. So there's a lot, those are just going to be scaled up and up, you know, they're critical to reaching net zero. And then there are also these projects which are integrated carbon capture and storage and hydrogen, you know, whether green hydrogen, blue hydrogen. So that, you know, if you look at any of these roadmaps to net zero, there's a lot of these newer technologies which are going to become much more widespread over the next 10, 20 years. So whether you're looking at engineers, you know, a range of different disciplines that would be needed to meet all the skills that we need for that. So, and of course, decommissioning, in fact, and because you're not only looking at decommissioning oil and gas eventually, you're also looking at decommissioning, you know, wind turbines and everything, that they all come to their end of their life as well. And we're even looking at reuse, repurposing of pipelines for, you know, the use of carbon dioxide or hydrogen or, so, yeah, I mean, it's a lot of very interesting things happening. So yeah, it's hard to kind of really narrow that down to exactly what disciplines, but that maybe gives you a little feel. And I think as well, in fact, well, we touched on it, several of us, the whole remote sensing, yeah, relying on you know, satellites. I saw some incredible statistics last week about something like 2,000 satellites going to be launched in the next 10, 15 years from Europe, including all these smaller ones. So that's another massive industry, I think. So I'll stop there, maybe.
Thank you very much. Yeah, that was quite good. And then Ben, a question for you, and kind of coming back to the, and it's a little bit based on what Wendy has said. Coming back to the students, I mean, in the experience that you had with the ID Gore students, they were mostly engineering students. And I remember we talked about the fact that they, you know, they are not scared of a formula. Unlike the ecology students, we always had to teach, you know, you throw the formula at them and they want to know precisely everything and they're not at all scared. And that's great. But I guess my question is, how much did they benefit from the more social side of things? Because I think there's maybe more interaction between the environmental science and the engineering, for instance. But you were talking about the philosophical discussions, and the reason I'm asking this is basically because one of the things Wendy hasn't mentioned is things like social license, or I mean, one of the reasons people, you know, would rather go for renewables to oil and gas is because of the social license of thinking that it's better for the environment type of thing. So has there been those kind of discussions at all with the social science groups? I'm not really, you look like you're confused. My question is, how did the social science courses influence the students? And do you think that it's helped? And is there something that could be taken up in the oil and gas, for instance?
Good question, long question. I think the information is taken in different ways by the students. There's information they can pick up immediately. So the environmental stuff they can understand, you know, the most obvious one is fouling on devices. You know, it's an immediate thing. It affects the operation of a device. There's also issues about invasive species and so on. There are other things that are longer term. And I think the social science, is two things. One is it really, we are discovering that social license really matters to the success of different projects. It can be, you know, a fantastic success of the local community helping out, or a total failure with the local community resisting. Small scale renewables is a particular example to that, you know, and with cost implications of pushing this stuff offshore because of complaints from local communities or different ways of structuring things. I think some of those questions, they go in as ideas to students now. The project they're doing, it won't be necessarily relevant unless they choose to work on that kind of thing. But as students become more senior in their careers and they end up on the sort of developmental side, making big strategic decisions, those kinds of understanding, realization about the nuances and importance of societal values and so on, feeds in. So as students go forward on their careers, these sorts of things might feed in several decades time. And so I think those seeds have been planted now. For some, they take root, and others, they won't flower until those students are much more senior in what they're doing. I think that's my perspective.
Thank you very much. I don't know if any of you guys, if you want to ask each other questions, that's also just wave at me and I'm happy to. Otherwise, I'll go down the list of questions that I sent you. Anybody? No? Gilles, you don't want
I would have a question to Wendy. So you say she didn't speak so much, but in fact, she will be the first speaker. As you talk about I will see if we can envisage, you say nobody will be interested in oil and gas in Europe at present, but in a fact, just to caricature, but there is one big problem that I've noticed in the discussion, especially in the, in English, as a GIEC is IGCC on the climate, is the understanding of the role that the seabed could have on the model they are doing. We have a lot of gas hydrates, were in the sediments. And at the moment, there is a big release of these gas hydrates, but the oceans, as a good ocean for the moment, would take the CO2, but also the methane is a good friend. But one day it will be tired of getting all this. And I wonder if there is any educations or any training to understand what could be the role of releasing gas hydrates, as it's what happened 8,200 years ago in Storegga in Norway, when there were a big release of gas hydrate, slope stability and so on. And I wonder if we can envisage to make the generation understand the role of the natural gas, which is not only to be burned, but it's only having a place in the process of the earth at that moment.
Yes, I mean, I think if I understand, you're talking about biogenic methane seepage from the seabed, is that right?
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's something that is, very little known when you're looking at the ocean as a whole. I think there are pockets pockets of the ocean that are better studied. And I know, for example, in the North Sea, you know, there's quite a good mapping of where that occurs naturally. And in the sort of central North Sea, you do get these pock marks and, you know, natural seepages. It's a very good point. And I know there are a lot of scientists starting to study this more. And, you know, obviously there's masses of the ocean that is very little studied still, and that they don't know what are the rates. But certainly in the areas where there have been oil and gas activity, they always undertake a site survey nowadays before they will drill a well, so they know whether there's any shallow gas, and obviously those are the areas that they will avoid. So with all that data, that gradually improves the understanding. But it's a very valid point. It's something that needs to be better studied and better understood. Sure.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Ben, did you have a question? You look like you have a question.
Sheila can read me well. I was just thinking about the, we're in a pandemic just now, and we've all learnt Zoom and umpteen programs for communicating and so on. And, you know, I said I was in Scotland, I could be in Tahiti doing this right now, except for the time zones. So there are big opportunities here for broadening out our geographic scope. But and so we're all getting used to putting stuff online, certainly teaching, we have to change modules from face-to-face to online type stuff. And the whole world is moving that direction awfully fast. However, there's also a real need for experiential type stuff where you actually, my pet example is having taught marine engineers for a year, I took them out onto the ferry to do some, there's a local ferry goes across and we do some competitive surveying. We have two teams and they go on opposite sides and they survey in competition with each other. And I said, team A go onto the port side and team B go onto the starboard side. I looked at 10 marine engineers and they looked at me blankly, not knowing what port and starboard were, and knowing where to go. And it just brought out, these are, they're great out of books and so on, but I guess there's the other side of practical side of things. And I guess, how do we balance that with the new opportunity that online is really bringing, particularly in terms of things like the geography? Open question.
I totally agree with the fact of needing some practical side for the training, and not only for the vocational, but I think that in all the trainings, in my opinion, and I have been working in organizing trainings for workshops for a lot of time, for building boats in wood and so on, you may have some blended contents, but you always will have to keep some practical part. The most you have this practical part, I think the better will be the learning. I don't have the source of the information, but I heard once that you can learn a lot by simulation, but the time this keeps this learning keeps is smaller than if you learn by doing. Indeed, this is one of the terms that that are being used by the commissioner, work-based learning, which is learning on the field, doing the things. And I think that we must try to blend the two opportunities of the online and the applied learning. And this will be a new generation of learnings.
Thanks, Wendy.
I think it's absolutely critical, Ben. I mean, one of my roles when I was based in Aberdeen, I was doing graduate recruitment into Total, and we used to take on about 40 graduates every year, and they had a 3-year training program before they then got proper positions within the company. And the first whole year, I would do with the sort of environment graduates, I would do my utmost to get them out in the field. So they would spend, at least a month or two on each of our sites. So they would spend, a month up at, St. Fergus or up at Shetland gas plant or out on, one of the offshore platforms. So, even though that wasn't what they were going to do eventually, they understood exactly all the roles, how things work. And I mean, that just made them way better in the end. So they absolutely knew what they were looking at. I mean, it's the same. I spent 12 years in an environmental consultancy before I joined Total. And so I was out there doing coastal, baseline, coastal sensitivity mapping and, actual surveys before I then, joined Total, and I gave that work to consultants to do. But I think unless you've actually done the stuff, I think some people just really it's very, very valuable, that training. And I agree, I think it's going to be really, really tough for students this year. I mean, my daughter's at university, I can see exactly what it is like. But I mean, they were going to have one day a week doing lab work, and now that's gone online, and it's just going to be videoed for them. And I just feel so, so sad for them, that they're not going to have that actual experience. But I don't know what it's like for industry, whether industry are offering those experiences. When you talk about the students that you have, you saying they're all they do get these opportunities to work in industry. I mean, I think that is invaluable, even if it's a month or two in during their course. I would think that would be very helpful. I don't know. I'd be interested to know how easy that is for you with offshore renewables or the kind of industries that you're working with, but I think it's very, very important. Yeah.
Just on that last point, the industry placements, I'm not involved in it, but it's really quite challenging because small companies have a lot of IP floating about, intellectual property, and companies are very, very nervous about slippage to the students who are just exposed to that side of things. Maybe if it's something that's more routine, then that's less of a problem, but it's been a real challenge. And also small companies headhunting the students halfway through the course is utterly maddening, but they've discovered somebody's got real skills and there's been multiple hirings, which is very annoying in relation to the degree to completion statistics for the education and funders. But it's extremely, it's extremely good to see transitioning, without any gap whatsoever into the sector. But IP has been, and some projects have been delayed over a year, agreeing with lawyers the risk of IP slippage.
Very much. That's been quite useful, actually. I I'm not sure if there's no other questions on the question board. And I have one more thing. We have like 3 minutes, so we can't talk about it too much, but I wanted to put it out there. And it was basically based on what Wendy said about the fact that some of their companies have facilities and work all across the world, and the fact that we now have these big online courses. And my question to all of you to think about, maybe we don't have to discuss it, is how do we enable, you know, people from the Global South, for instance, to help with these things? I mean, there are obviously, Lucia was talking about the fact that we don't have enough skilled people. We are, you know, we are drilling in West Africa. We are doing things all across the globe. And with these massive online courses, I think there's definitely something that we can do to make, to enable more skill development across the world. And then on top of that, when we were talking about the fact that people now can't go out in the field, can't go to the labs, one of the things I think we should look at is sort of the pedagogical side of how they train medical students. For instance, I think, you know, a couple of decades ago, medical students would cut up cadavers, and as far as I know, they don't do that so much anymore. So they obviously have found a way to make this more hands-on without being hands-on. So there's something to do there where we need to look at how do we skill people up on things that we can't skill them up on because we are sort of stuck indoors. So I actually don't know if anybody has something briefly to say on that, that'd be great. Otherwise, this is just for people to think about later. No? Okay, so I'll leave it at that. That was just my musings. I do now, we were asked to kind of close promptly. So I will just want to thank you all. Thank the speakers. Thank Jill, Wendy, Ben and Lucia for joining us. It's been really great. And we've had a really fruitful discussion. I think we could have had a longer discussion actually. And I'll just summarize, I guess, by saying I think from what we've seen today is that there's quite a need and good skills. It's possible for us to work together. There's good examples of where working together works really well. We should probably do it more. And I think there's benefits both from academic side and from the side of the industry. So we should definitely do this more. But of course, in the brave new world we're stepping into, we need to think about how we're going to do this properly, how we're going to do this, you know, intelligently. Ben was saying, you know, we're actually getting people, we have to train students that are going to be dealing with things in the decades to come when it's not really our skill set. And I think we have to think about the fact that we're also training students for the ocean decade. So, you know, in 10 years time, when we get to the end of the ocean decade, we're going to have all the skills to address all the problems that we have in the ocean and that are not going to go away. So I think with that, I would just want to thank you all. Thank you very much. It was very fruitful, very interesting discussion. And enjoy the rest of CTEC week. And do, if you have time to go and see the EOS Technology Forum, I think it will be very interesting discussions. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks very much. Thanks for
Thank you.